Kajsab, it's all yours. Here, thank you. Here.
No, podium.
Oh, you'll have to be. Oh, you need a note. Okay. You need a chair?
No, I'm fine. I'm fine.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Ibaadatkhana. Today is a red letter day, 8th of December, a red letter day in the history of our subcontinent. Now, some of you may think I'm exaggerating, that this function today is going to affect the history of India, but I would like to explain. But before explaining, I would like to tell you how this concept of Ibaadatkahna came to our core group, Tasavvur, others, Ritu, and so on, Santosh. You see, in Dallas, a friend of mine informed me that they are having Eid Diwali Milan on 9th of November. A friend of mine, Shakti, who's a Tamilian living in Dallas, he had telephoned me a long time back in September that they are going to have Eid Diwali Milan. Diwali was on 27th October, and Eid ul Milad un Nabi, that is birthday of the Prophet, was on 10th November. So they said, we are going to have an Eid Diwali Milan. So we thought that this is a very good idea. We should have a similar thing in the Bay Area too. But why confine it to just Eid and Diwali? Why confine it to Hindus and Muslims? Why not include Sikhs and Christians, other faiths also? Because Gurpurab, that is the birthday of Guru Nanak, was falling on 12th of November, just 2 days after the birthday of Prophet Muhammad. And Christmas is, as you know, on 25th December, the birthday of Jesus Christ. So why not combine four faiths instead of limiting it to two? So we decided that this is a good idea. Let's have an interfaith harmony function. And the idea, the word Ibaadatkhana, I must tell you how it arose, because some people said, oh, this only represents Muslims. Why should Hindus and Christians join Ibaadatkhana? So we explained that, look, the word Ibaadatkhana has a historical context. This Ibaadatkhana, whose picture you see here, this is actually a building, if you go to Fatehpur Sikri, which is the new capital of Emperor Akbar, who shifted his capital from Agra to Fatehpur Sikri in the year 1570. And for 15 years, that was the capital when he came back to Agra. And he built this house of worship. It's something unique in the world. It has never happened. Because this was the place where scholars of all religions, Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Parsis, Jains, they would all come to this building. You can, even now, if you go to Fatehpur Sikri, which is 30 kilometers west of Agra, you people go to see the Taj Mahal, I would recommend also go and see Fatehpur Sikri. And scholars of all religions would come and debate with each other, point out the good points in their religion in a peaceful, harmonious way. This was in the 1570s. And mind you, at that time, Europeans were massacring each other in the name of religion in the 16th century. Catholics massacring Protestants. If you've been students of European history, you may have heard of Saint Bartholomew Day massacre in France. Oh. Saint Bartholomew Day massacre, where Catholics massacred the Protestants who were called Huguenots in France in 1572. And similarly, there were massacres in many parts. Massacre means not just men, massacring women, children. There was bloodbaths in Europe going on in the name of religion. At that time, Emperor Akbar proclaimed his doctrine of Sulh-e-Kul, which means universal toleration of all religions, giving equal respect to all religions, And he even practiced it because he appointed Hindus to the highest post like Birbal and Todarmal and Mansingh. In fact, that is how the Mughal Empire lasted so long, because it took everybody along with it. So this was, this shows Emperor Akbar was 200 years ahead of his time. And unique, this building, you will not hear of it anywhere in the world, where there's a building where people of all religions come together and they talk peacefully, amicably about the good points in their religion. Something unique. And Akbar was a unique. Today, whatever we are today, let me tell you, in the Indian subcontinent, it is because of Emperor Akbar, the foundation which he laid, that you see, it's a country of great diversity. You must give equal respect to everybody. Otherwise, our country cannot survive for one day. There's so much tremendous diversity. So that is why we have named this function the Ibaadatkhana function. And we intend every 8th of December, we will have this Ibaadatkhana day, apart from having functions on other days also. Now, here I would like to tell you something about India, because I mean, many of you are from, I think most of you are from the Indian subcontinent, but how many of you know what is India? I think perhaps none of you know. Now, so let me tell you. See, India is broadly a country of immigrants. It is like North America. In North America, people came mainly from Europe over the last, say, 400 years. In India, they have been coming for thousands of years into India. 92-93% people living in India today are not the original inhabitants of India. Their ancestors came from abroad, mainly from the Northwest. Only 7-8% people living in India today can claim to be the original inhabitant. Even the Dravidians came from outside. Earlier it was thought that Dravidians were the original inhabitants and Aryans came from outside. But now it has been accepted that even the Dravidians came from outside, because there's a language called Brahui in Balochistan, which is a Dravidian language. And these pre-Dravidian tribals are the original inhabitants of India. These tribals called Bhils or Gonds or Santhals or Todas of the Nilgiris, they are just 7-8% of our population. Their ancestors were slaughtered in great numbers by our ancestors. They were treated very badly, driven into forests where many of them still live. So they are the original inhabitants. Otherwise, rest of us, in a sense, are foreigners in India. It's a country of immigrants. Why did people come into India instead of going out of India? Only on two occasions people left India. One was in the 19th century when the British sent the plantation labor to Fiji and Mauritius and British Guyana and so on. Those were the poor peasants living in Bihar or eastern UP. They were sent as into the sugarcane plantations or tobacco plantation. The other wave was the recent diaspora of the highly educated Indian professionals, the IIT engineers and doctors and so on, who came over the last 40 years or so. Otherwise, nobody left India. Everybody kept coming into India. Why? Because people migrate from uncomfortable areas to comfortable areas. It is natural. Everybody wants comfort. Now, earlier there were no industrial societies. There were agricultural societies. What do you require for agriculture? You require level land. You require fertile soil. You require plenty of water for irrigation. All this was in abundance in the Indian subcontinent. If you go from Rawalpindi to Bangladesh to deep south Kanyakumari, all level land, fertile soil, it was paradise for agriculture. Why should anybody migrate from India to, say, Afghanistan, which is covered with snow for 4 or 5 months in a year, rocky, mountainous, harsh terrain, uncomfortable? Everybody wants comfort. So people for thousands of years kept rolling into India. This was paradise for agriculture. And because it's a country of immigrants, there's so much diversity in India. Because whichever group of immigrants came over thousands of years, they brought their own language, their religion, their culture, their way of life. That is why there are so many religions in India, so many castes, so many languages, so many ethnic groups, somebody's tall, somebody's short, somebody's fair, somebody's dark. If you compare India with, say, China, see, China and India have about the same population. That is a little over 1.3 billion each. But there's broad homogeneity in China. Not absolute homogeneity, but broad homogeneity. For example, all Chinese have a common written script called Mandarin. Of course, Mandarin is also a spoken language, but there are other spoken languages like Cantonese in southern China and all. But the written script is the same. And 95% Chinese belong to one ethnic group called the Hans, H-A-N. There's broad homogeneity in China. They look alike. Whereas in India, there's tremendous diversity. So the only way to keep the country together and take it on the path of progress is the path shown by Emperor Akbar, called Sulh-e-Kul, that is giving equal respect to everybody. Otherwise, our country just cannot survive. What is there common between you and that boy from Nagaland? You are Hindus or Muslims, he is a Christian. You have got Caucasian features, he has got Mongoloid features. You are, his language is different, his eating habits are different, his dress. So unless you give him equal respect, why should he remain inside India? There's such diversity. So that the only path shown, path for keeping India together and taking it on the path of progress is the path shown by Emperor Akbar. He is the real father of the Indian nation. I have always said, today whatever we are is because of Emperor Akbar. He gave equal respect to everybody. Unfortunately, what has happened in recent years in India, and I'm sad to say so, dark clouds have come over India. People have come into power who are spreading religious hatred in India, polarizing society. You must have heard of cases of lynching of Muslims and beating up Muslims, terrorizing minorities, vandalizing churches. People whose mindset is the feudal mindset of trying to dominate by the so-called Hindutva philosophy. This is the very, very dangerous trend which has come into India. And it is the path of ruin, a path for total breakup of India. Because, as I said, the very spirit and the identity of India is that it is a country of diversity. You have to give respect to everybody, otherwise, as I said, it's a country of immigrants. You must give respect to everybody. Now, today what has happened is the people who are in power, they have created an atmosphere of fear among minorities, apart from lynching, their hate speeches, beating up people who don't say Jai Shri Ram. Do you know in many schools, Shaista Ji is sitting here, where Shaista Ji? She told me that in school, and I also know, in many schools, the Hindu boys tell the Muslim boys that you are terrorists, you are Pakistani, and tell your father, throw bombs. Look at the mentality which has come among children, and you can imagine how much trauma that Muslim child would be having, that he's being made to feel unwelcome in his own country. He's told he's an anti-national. This propaganda is very widespread. Unfortunately, state institutions have collapsed. I'm sorry to say I am from the Supreme Court, but Supreme Court of India has surrendered to these forces, which is evident from the Ayodhya verdict they gave. Shameful verdict. They sanctified gross illegality. And in India, the media has surrendered largely. Media has become shameless largely. History and science have been perverted. Polarization has become acute in India. Even in your Bay Area, I mean, you people are living in a very modern country, but I found there's tremendous polarization even among NRIs in America. And you claim to be very educated people. This is the reality of the situation. Now, I want to tell you, before 1857, there was no communal problem in India. Now, this is, you must hear me very carefully. Javed Saab, suniye. Aap gossip kar rahe hai, I've noticed. Suniye. No, you have to hear me very, very, very seriously. Dekhiye, before 1857, there was no communal problem in India. You will not hear of any communal riot before 1857. Ha, it is true that the Muslim invaders who came into India, they destroyed a lot of Hindu temples. This is true. For example, Mahmud Ghaznavi broke the Somnath temple. True. But the descendants of those Muslim invaders, like for instance, Babur was an invader, but his grandson Akbar was not an invader. He was born in India, he was an Indian. So the descendants of the Muslim invaders who became local kings in India, far from breaking Hindu temples, they gave grants for Hindu temples, they promoted secularism in their own interest. See, because they 80-90% population was Hindu. If you are a Muslim king, if you break Hindu temples, every day there will be a revolt, there will be chaos, riots. No king wants that. Every king wants to live in peace, enjoy life. So in their own interest, all the Muslim kings of India, who were the descendants of the invaders, they, far from breaking temples, they gave grants. There are hundreds and thousands of documents showing the grants given by the Muslim kings to the Hindu temples. And promoting, fostering secularism. Mughal kings used to promote secularism. Nawab of Awadh, I belong to UP, he used to organize Ram Leela and participate in Holi in Diwali. Before 1857, there was no communal problem in India. Hindus used to participate in Eid and Muharram. Muslims used to participate in Holi, Diwali. There was no, they lived like brother and sister. There was no problem. This communal problem begins from 1857. You must understand this. Javed Saab, suniye. 1857 se sab ye shararat shuru hoti hai. This mischief start. Dekhiye, kya hua 1857 mein the mutiny broke out. There was a Hindus and Muslims jointly fought against the British. After suppressing the mutiny, the British decided that the only way to control India was divide and rule. It all begins from 1857, and the proof of it, if you go on Google, you just type history in the service of imperialism. History in the service of imperialism. This was a speech given by Professor B.N. Pandey in the Raj Sabha, the upper house of Indian Parliament, in which he has given details about the letters which came from the Secretary of State for India in London to the Viceroy here in India that make Hindus and Muslims fight with each other. Everything begins from 1857. All communal riots begin from 1857. The English collector would secretly call the Hindu Panditji in the night, give him money, and tell him from tomorrow start speaking against Muslims. Similarly, he would call the Muslim Maulana secretly in the night, give him money, and tell him from tomorrow speak against Hindus. Then agent provocateurs were hired. I mean, you slaughter four cows, throw them overnight into Hindu temples and write on the wall, Allahu Akbar. So from next day, the Hindus will think, people are gullible. Hindus will think all the Muslims are mischievous people. Similarly, you slaughter four pigs, throw them into mosques and write on the wall, Jai Shri Ram. So Muslims will believe all these Hindus are mischievous people. All this poison was injected after 1857, year after year, decade after decade. Then in 1909, the Minto-Mawla reforms came that separate electorates. In 1909, it was provided that Hindus can only vote for Hindu candidate, Muslims can vote only for Muslim candidate. Then this propaganda was done that Hindi is the language of Hindus and Urdu is the language of Muslims. when the truth is that Urdu was the common language of everybody. I mean, my father, grandfather knew only Urdu. It was not the language of Muslims alone. Urdu was the, up to 1947, it was the language of Hindus, Sikhs, Muslim, everybody. But to divide and rule, again, this propaganda was done. So all this poison was injected year after year, decade after decade, and it resulted in partition. Now, I'm not going into all that. I myself have said many times that this partition is a historical British swindle, and we will again reunite one day. However, I need not go into all this. But the point is that while India proclaimed itself to be a secular country, it's all very well to write something in the constitution. But what is the ground reality? Today, the ground reality is that religious hatred is being spread, polarization is being done in society at the at every level in India. Propaganda is being done to divide Hindus and Muslims. And because Hindus are almost 80% in India, Muslims are only 15-16%. So they are at the receiving end. So today, there's a terrible economic crisis in India. For the last few months, the Indian economy is tanking. The manufacturing sector is going down. One indicator is the auto sector in India, the indication which indicates the health of the economy. 30-40% auto sales have gone down over the last couple of months. Real estate is in the dumps. IT, there are lakhs of jobs which have been lost. 12 million youth are entering the job market every year in India. 12 million. But the jobs are getting less. What are these millions of young people going to do? Either they commit suicide, or they become criminals, or what do? This is the situation. Every second child in India is malnourished. The highest amount of malnourishment in the world. Every second woman is anemic in India. So there's a terrible situation in India, a terrible economic crisis of India. The rulers of India have no means of solving this problem, so they must have a scapegoat, just like Hitler had the Jews. So they have the Muslims. They are nice beating boys. That is because of Muslims that all these problems have arisen. And this is going to increase, I'm telling you, in India. Because these chaps have no way of solving the real problems, which are the economic problems. Article 370, people say, was it good, was it bad? I said, look, it was a gimmick to divert attention of the people from the economic, terrible economic crisis which India is going through. You divert attention, oh, Article 370, as if it is going to help the Kashmiri people. Rather, it has made the lives of Kashmiris miserable. I mean, just imagine, even going one day without internet will make you miserable. And Kashmiris have been deprived of internet for 110 days, 120 days, tasavvur, how many days? Sorry? 125 days. And then curfews, and there's no freedom of speech. People are under arrest. Farooq Abdullah, 82-year-old man, what harm can he do to anybody? You have gagged the people of Kashmir. So today I appeal to all of you that we must also pass a resolution in support of the Kashmiri people. And we must condemn the action of the Indian government, which has suppressed freedom of speech, freedom of media, and imprisoned people, and you know, clamped down on the internet and other facilities. So, before I conclude, how many minutes more do I have? Sorry, is it over? 2 minutes? Okay. All right. So I have told you now. Let me conclude by telling you I have called Emperor Akbar the father of the Indian nation. Because that is the policy. We must bring back India on the correct tracks. Presently, Indian train has been derailed by the present rulers. And we are being taken towards the path of destruction. We have to bring back our country and put it on the correct tracks so that we move in the direction showed by Emperor Akbar, that is of Sulh-e-Kul. So Emperor Akbar is the father of the Indian nation. Emperor Ashok, I have called the grandfather of the Indian nation. I don't know how much you know about him. He became king in 268 BC, and he was a king till 232 BC. For 36 years, he was the emperor. First emperor in the world who, after a conquest, apologized. He expressed remorse and regret. Nobody has done it. You have great conquerors like Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, Napoleon. Nobody has apologized and expressed regret and remorse after a victory. He did it after the Battle of Kaling, and he said, I'm very sorry that I did this, which has resulted in the death of so many people. Now, in the 12th major rock edict of Emperor Ashok, 12th major rock edict, he says, those people who only praise their own religion and condemn the religion of others, they are harming their own religion. They are damaging their own religion. Now look at the nobility of this thought. In fact, it is the same as Sulh-e-Kul, which Emperor Akbar proclaimed. So I regard Emperor Ashok as the grandfather of the Indian nation. And now this is something you may have heard for the first time. I regard Ram as the great grandfather of the Indian nation. And I want to tell you why. Because for many people, you know, Ram has become a symbol of lynching of Muslims and atrocities on Muslims. There was a song, Jo na bole Jai Shri Ram, bhej do usko kabristan. You may have heard, Jo na bole Jai Shri Ram, bhej do usko kabristan. So, but this is a totally wrong image. If you read the Sanskrit Ramayana, written by Valmiki, maybe 5th century BC or 1000 BC, wherever, there is a scene where Ram's father, King Dashrath, who had become very old, he was king of Ayodhya, and he decided to hand over the kingship to his eldest son, Ram. But before doing so, he invited the people of Ayodhya and asked them for their opinion, that is, does Ram deserve to be your king? Please tell me. Now, first of all, look at the democratic element, that you will not become king automatically just because you are the eldest son of the previous king. You have to also get approval of the people. And the people of Ayodhya replied, I will first quote in Sanskrit, then I will translate in English. Nikhile nanu purvyacha pita putrani vaurasan sushu shante chava shishya kachid varma sudanchita itiva purush vyagra sada ramo bhibhashite vyasaneshu manushyanam vrisham bhavita sukhita dukhita utsaveshu cha sarveshu pite parituṣyati. Which means, O king, your son Ram indeed deserves to be the next king, because he behaves like a father to the people. He grieves with us when we are in sorrows, when we have any calamity, any tragedy, he grieves along with us. And he is happy when we celebrate festivals. So a true father is one who looks after all his children. He is not selective that he looks only after some children, but he oppresses other children. So similarly, a true ruler is one who will not only look after Hindus, but he will also look after Muslims, also look after Christians and Sikhs and Parsis, everybody. If Ram had been the king today, he would have, far from getting Muslim lynched, he would have punished those people who lynched Muslim. He would have seen they were hanged. He would have stopped any kind of oppression on anybody. This is the, see, because people don't know. So that is why I've described Akbar as the father of the Indian nation, Ashok as the grandfather of the Indian nation, and Ram as the great grandfather of the Indian nation. So today you are creating history, believe me. Today we are going to put India back on the correct tracks. It has been derailed. Our train has been derailed by the present rulers, who are taking the country on the path of destruction. And we are again putting it back again on the correct road, the correct path shown by Emperor Akbar. Thank you.
Huh?
Thank you, Justice Saab. I know you would love to hear more, and I really would love to have Justice Katju speak more. Everybody wants to hear him. He has a lot to say. But unfortunately, we don't have much time. We did run a little bit over. But I just, before I introduce the other members and the speakers, I'd like to state that it's very important to understand Ibaadatkhana concept stands for communal harmony. And of course, the whole idea is when there is harmony, when there is peace, every nation has progressed. Every country has progressed. If you read history, whether in Kashmir, whenever there was communal harmony, there was a king who was very secular. Kashmir was the most prosperous place that time. And that happened in the Mughal era. And that happens today in the Western world, right? But prosperity without justice and fairness is not good enough, right? Germany was a very prosperous country, but there was not justice, there was not fairness against for Jews, right? Jews were massacred. I was always doing the right thing. So a prosperous system where there's communal harmony, there's fairness, there's justice, that's what we are looking for, right? That's what we are, you know, that's what our goal is, that's our vision is at Ibaadatkhana. And so I'd like to invite Justice Katju, who's already here, already introduced him.